我第一个对手是 DD Honey。
이번에첫상대가이제대만선수인 UCCU 선수인데사실아는정보가별로없어서
这样子其实我对他蛮陌生的，只有在 VOD 上面看过。
어떤식으로들고왔을지는거의모르겠지만상대적으로뭐쉬울것같습니다아마제가우승할것같습니다
这次我已经有做完万全准备了，我们就去做了很多牌，说要什么 ban pick， 然后还有一些现在什么主流牌最多，然后我们去做针对。
알려진게별로핸디캡이라고생각되지않는게있던카드들이아닌카드들을많이쓰기때문에사람들이그걸의식할수밖에없는플레이를좀유발을많이합니다
我觉得我可能不是亚洲最厉害的，可是我是比较擅长于分析战略跟决定牌组的。
아마그분도역시제덱에이런거파괴전기가있나이런식으로도생각을할수있어서
认真的把每场都打完，然后尽量不要失误，这就是我觉得我这次必须要做到的事情。
Oh boy, we are back with more Hearthstone action here on the Asia Pacific Championships. I'm Doa Guys. With me, of course, is Brian Kibler, and I'm excited about this next match. That video got me pumped. I'm from Korea, you know. Well, I live there anyway. I'm not from there originally, but. Dione is such an entertaining player, man. And he's right. He always puts this crazy stuff in his decks. He's known for that. He's a big streamer in Korea. So it's going to be interesting to see how that transitions now to such a serious match.
Yeah, he's known primarily as an entertainer, but has said that he's really looking to do his best to try and win this event.
Mm-hmm. It's a good idea. To try to win.
Usually my strategy.
That That's a great idea. But UCCU, he's going to be trying to win the event too. And guys, you can actually tell us who you think is going to win the event. Either hashtag Daihani or hashtag UCCU on Twitter. Tweet that at PlayHearthstone with the hashtag HCT. And so now, I think it's time to maybe learn a little bit more about our players. What do you think?
Yeah, we're going to meet UCCU here.
That's right. Time to meet UCCU.
So UCCU, player from Taiwan, as in this matchup, definitely the underdog coming in, a much less well-known player than Daihani, but he has said he's going to be doing his best to upset the streaming star.
Yeah, I mean, he ended up going into the final match in the Taiwan qualifier after 3-0ing the other opponent, and he looked strong doing it. He went on to be 3-0'd in the end by Pinpingho, but... He looked good up to that match, so we'll see. I mean, kind of on both sides of the 3-0 coming into this one, but certainly a player with a lot of questions about him, right? But now it's time to introduce his opponent, Daihani.
Daihani is the most popular streamer in Korea. You can see
I love this guy.
Just walking in.
I love this guy.
A big personality, great character, and from what I've seen of his matches, tends to play really exciting decks that I can kind of get behind.
He does, man. I mean, when Papa Smithy and I were casting the preliminaries in Korea a few weeks ago, Daihani's one of his semifinal matches ended up being 5 Golden Monkeys played in four games between him and his opponent. Most of them came from him, too. So, yeah, this is a guy that he likes to have fun with the game.
I feel a kind of spiritual kinship here.
Yes.
Somebody who likes to play gold monkey decks in tournaments, streamer loves to play fun decks, I can get behind him.
I know what you mean. And I mean, he's right. That is sometimes something that your opponent isn't going to be expecting. It's something that's hard to deal with because it really kind of throws off your entire practice mentality. You know, you're put in situations that you don't really have a lot of experience dealing with.
Yeah, I think that people tend to undervalue just being unpredictable.
Yeah.
You know, when people see decks that they're used to playing against, they have, okay, this is what I'm going to mulligan for. This is what my plan is. But if you can bring strategies that players don't anticipate, you can often gain an edge.
Yeah, very, very true. I mean, it's weird to kind of think of how sometimes playing a deck that's worse technically is going to give you an edge. But that's how it works in a lot of CCGs and certainly works in Hearthstone too. So let's take a look at the poll results, see where things are at between Daihani and UCCU. And right now looks like they're dead even. But I can't blame them. I mean, we've got a lot of fans seeing these players for the first time. They may not know who to vote for, so I think they're gonna have to see a game or two before we see any swings one way or the other.
Yeah, the Western audience doesn't get a chance to get to know these players all that often, which is one of the things that makes this particular event so exciting.
Yep, That's right.
We have the lineups here. So it looks like Daihani bringing Warrior, which has been banned, Druid, Mage, and Warlock, while UCCU has the sole Shaman in the tournament, while his Warrior is also banned, and he is also playing Mage and Druid.
Yeah, you'd have to assume that's going to be some sort of aggro Shaman, but we've seen a lot less aggro Shaman overall in tournaments across the board here. Why do you think it's kind of falling off?
Well, the Americas Championship saw two players bring aggro Shaman.
Yeah.
Chalky ended up having a pretty rough run of it with his. Mm-hmm. Nostum played his all the way through to the finals. But it is a deck that can tend to struggle in certain matchups. If your opponent has the ability to shut down some of your early game, you don't have a powerful hero power like Hunter. We saw Hunter have a big resurgence at the European Championship just last weekend.
Yeah, now both of these guys banned out each other's Warriors too. So if you're playing the aggro Shaman, I can see why you wouldn't really want to face the Warrior.
Yeah,
but
Warrior has been probably the most banned class, I think, across at least the European Championship. Warrior and Warlock are the two most common bans we've seen quite often.
I mean, two of the classes that have the biggest swings in terms of what type of deck you can bring, too. You've got Patron Control, Zoo, Reno Lock, Handlock once in a while.
Yeah, I mean, there's definitely, they're the most represented classes, generally speaking, as well. So they're going to show up more often to possibly get banned. But it looks like into the game, UCCU does have that aggro Shaman deck, while Daihani, this looks to be aggro Warlock. Where's the cool deck? What's going on?
I don't know. Aggro's cool to me. I think these are cool decks. And honestly, they've got pretty good cards as we move into the first game between Daihani and UCCU. I mean, you're going to maybe want to throw back the Lightning Bolt in this mulligan, but...
Yeah, the interesting thing here, UCCU doesn't necessarily have information about what Daihani's playing.
Yeah.
As you're saying, he tends to be unpredictable. So he doesn't necessarily have the information. If anything, from what I have heard about Daihani, he doesn't seem to be a player who I would put on playing aggro Zoo at all.
Well, I mean, rumor is always out there in any event Daihani's in, that he's brought some weird, crazy deck, and like you don't know if he's messing with you, if it's actually true. We'll find out. Looks like pretty standard Zoo so far from Daihani.
UCCU chooses not to just go three to the face turn one. I can respect that.
Dude, there was a time in like the first week of closed beta where you would just get lightning bolted or rock biter weaponed on turn one. You're like, oh.
You got to send a message, you know? You got to tell them what this game's going to be about.
That's right. I had an aggro Shaman deck like way back in closed beta.
It must have been horrible.
It was so good. It was really, really good. Ask Artosis sometime, man. I beat all the decks he took to BlizzCon that first year. It was sick.
Daihani with the coin knife juggler turn one. UCCU.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, the Leopardome actually makes this turn a little bit more interesting. He has the option to play Leopardome and remove that knife juggler, or just play that Totem Golem.
Yeah, I kind of like the Leper Gnome and the Lightning Bolt. You're still going to be able to play the Totem Golem next turn. You get something on the board that sticks. Do you feel like the Totem Golem is just a little bit too risky to put out there?
But one of the problems with Totem Golem here, not only does it overload you for next turn, but if your opponent does hit a juggle on it with the juggler, he can just trade his minion straight up.
True.
And it's your biggest threat. It's actually pretty important that you're able to potentially get some damage in with that Totem Golem rather than having it just immediately removed.
Yeah, so he's going to save it a little bit. That's a good idea. Haunted Creeper is going to come down for Daihani this turn.
Haunted Creeper, the natural predator of the Leper Gnome.
Yep.
It does line up very well, both killing the Leper Gnome and getting the spiders remaining. Totem Golem, though, is the biggest guy in the block right now.
Yeah, and early game, it is kind of tough for Zulok to handle those four health minions unless you have something like a Power Overwhelming in your hand or a couple abusive sergeants. It's a bit tricky. There, of course, is a spider, like you said, preying on its natural prey, the Leper Gnome, apparently immune to radiation. And it just dropped down into Ruby, and I can avoid Walker as well.
It's a surprise that. Ooh,
oh, there we go.
Elemental. It was Daihani who was talking about, oh, you're going to play Elemental Destruction? Well, UCCU is the one who has it here.
Yeah, he might need it, too. I mean, you don't want to really pop the egg with it yet, but he's already feeling quite a bit of pressure here.
Yeah, he has actually. More, you know, an equivalent amount of attack on board against Daihani with his one minion against all of Daihani's. He does have the tools to potentially kill the Voidcaller or Voidwalker. Voidcaller, Voidwalker. Those always trip me up.
Yeah.
Void guy.
Void something, you know? Void person. We call them Void people, Brian
Kibler. Okay. All right. Yeah. All right.
And Defender of Argus, that is
a nice draw here.
Yeah.
Not necessarily exactly what he's going to do this turn, but it's very key in this matchup. Defender of Argus allowing the aggressive Warlock deck the ability to defend itself, but Power Overwhelming and more. That's a an embarrassment of riches. You kind of want all of them.
Yeah, I know. It's actually a tough choice. Usually you get like a couple things in Power Overwhelming. He's going to go with the Power Overwhelming anyway. Had a chance to draw and trade with the Spider.
Yeah, the Power Overwhelming, though, does let him spawn the 4-4 and clear off this Horse Rider and play Void Color. So
it does.
Suddenly quite the board here from Dianne. There is that Elmo Destruction that UCCU has, but the overload of 5 will shut down his ability to do anything else next turn.
Yeah, man, UCCU is in a really tough spot, because if he plays the Feral Spirits, he's not going to get a lot of value out of him. If he plays the Elemental Destruction, like you said, he's going to just be giving up his next turn, essentially. And this is one of the strengths that Zoo Warlock has against Aggro Shaman. This is one of the reasons why Aggro Shaman started going away, because against Zoo, it kind of forces the Aggro Shaman sometimes to try to play like a Zoo deck, but it really isn't built to do that. So it just kind of stalls out like we're seeing.
Yeah, the problem is the Aggro Shaman deck relies so heavily on getting a lot of damage in with those early minions.
Right.
And then getting to the stage of the game where it can just go to the face with Burn, where it can play Doomhammer, go to the face with Doomhammer.
Yeah.
But The Zoo deck has a superior early game by a fair margin as well, and it's able to contain that early damage. Dianne, he's only taken 6 and forced UCCU to fire off that Elemental Destruction already.
You know, it's sad, but I really can't blame UCCU for doing it. There was really no other great option there. And like you said, where you need those early minions, that makes those Feral Spirits all the more valuable, but they're not going to hit the board until turn 7 at the earliest. So Dianne right now can kind of play it pretty casually, I think, this turn.
It does choose to deploy that wolf rather than using Life Tap this turn.
I've never heard anyone say deploy a wolf before. It's like if you've got like a wolf army, like deploy the wolves.
Unleash the hounds.
I suppose.
What do you do with wolves if you don't deploy them?
See, it's a wild animal, so that's you unleash wild animals.
That's true.
You deploy like soldiers and stuff. You know?
It's interesting here from Dianne. If he had Life Tap that turn, he would have been guaranteed to be able to play a minion to go with his egg, and play that defender between them.
Yeah.
So here, because he exposed that wolf to a removal effect from UCCU, he's not going to get maximum value out of this defender if he plays this turn.
It did kind of seem like Dianne got just a little bit lazy that turn. He's like, he probably can't handle it.
I'll play these guys. He's overloaded. Yeah. But ended up kind of getting a little bit punished there for that decision.
For
now
sure.
UCCU, he's able to start playing spells again. He's quite a few of them, too.
I mean, he's got some options here. But the thing is if you picture a world, right, where he maybe runs the Argent Horse right into the egg and then Lava Bursts the Nerubian, that's like a plausible play, but it still feels bad to use that spell that's supposed to go to face on a minion like that, especially with such a small hand. Do you think we might just see him get as many minions out there as he can, just Feral Spirits, Horse Rider, Leper Gnome?
I think that's not an unreasonable play. He could also just play Feral Spirits, Leper Gnome, Totem. If you really wanted to be a little bit conservative with that use. The problem is he will have 6 mana next turn, so he could play Argent plus the Horse Rider as well. Yeah, he goes with just that because playing the Horse Rider, he's not going to attack with it, so he's just kind of exposing it for no real gain.
Nobody wants Horse Rider exposed.
Oh, no.
This is a show for young adults, Rank Killer.
So Dianne, he looks like he's just going to go with the Defender again. He has 7 mana, so he could choose to Life Tap, Power Overwhelming, and then Defender on the Spider, or on a second minion here. It looks like he just may play the Lotheb.
I mean, it gets a decent body on the board. If you play that Lotheb, you know they're going to be tempted to throw the minions they have into it, which just puts you in a better place as a Zoolock player, I suppose.
Yeah, if he plays Lotheb too, it gives him a very large body that he can potentially Defender on next turn.
Yeah.
It also shuts UCCU out of casting anything but 1-cost spells because of the overload that he's under as well.
I'd lean towards the Lotheb. We'll see what he does. No. Looks like he's going to go with the Power Overwhelming play, though. Wants to get that Nerubian out.
I like this because it allows him to also play the Defender and kill the second wolf.
That's a good
point. Oh, actually, yeah. Maybe I don't quite like this. He does get the Nerubian here. But he does lose his Defender, and now he's used both Defender of Argus. So this leaves him open to any charge minions that UCCU is able to muster, as well as having no defense against a possible Doomhammer that could be drawn in future turns.
I mean, frankly, if you're UCCU now, you see what you just said. You're like, all right, I run my Leper Gnome and the Defender of Argus, and then it's like face is the place time. It's do or die.
I actually you have a Spell Power Totem in play as well. I think from UCCU, attacking the Defender Vargas and just pointing all of that burn in, at face while you have the Wrath of Air Totem in play, how much damage are you doing? You're doing 6, 7, 8 from Leprenome,
plus potential
up to 7 from Crackle.
Yeah.
So that's just a lot of damage.
He's going to choose to preserve his Leprenome as long as he can. Can't blame him there either, but yeah, I mean, right now, this is it. Like, UCUCU can't stop being aggressive now. Mm-hmm. It's win or lose.
Oh, well, there's Dr. Boom.
Does that really help Daini, though? Depends on what UCCU draws, I suppose.
Dr. Boom does help insofar as it generates a very fast clock. At this point, Daihini is really in a position where he has to close up the game as fast as possible.
Yeah.
The Dr. Boom plus that Lotheb in his hand can potentially help close UCCU's window that he has to find burn spells.
Now, would you go for the Spell Power Totem? I feel like I'd be more inclined to hit that since more or less guarantees you're only going to take 2 damage from the Leprenome.
Well,
you're going
most,
into a turn where you might die.
At most, the Spell Power Totem is representing 2 damage next turn, while Leprenome naturally is just representing 2 damage by attacking you no matter what
True.
The cards on UCCU's hand are. So I think I would probably kill the Leprenome.
So many possibilities.
See what he's thinking. He's going to go for the Totem. All right. I mean, maybe he's worried about something like Ancestral...
Though it would have to be Ancestral Knowledge into
Ancestral
multiple
knowledge.
Cheap burn spells here. Does Fire Off Totem.
All right, gets a 1-1. And, I mean, you could just drop that Tunnel Trog and Crackle, I suppose.
I mean,
get stuff on the board.
Yeah, I mean, UCCU is in a position where he has to end the game ASAP. He's facing down so much power on Dainese's side of the board that I feel like he just needs to go face.
Yeah, that's definitely what he's going to do. How much damage is the Crackle? It is 6.
Oh,
wow, he gets the full
damage
6.
Crackle with that Leprenome in play.
That's big.
That means all UCCU needs to do is find something that deals 1 damage next turn. And Daini has to spend his resources clearing off his entire board, including Searing Totem.
Yeah, yeah, he's got to kill absolutely everything on the board. And even then, even with Lotheb, if there's a lightning ball drawn by, a lightning bolt rather, drawn by UCCU, that's it.
Yeah, this is a really bad spot for Daini. Not only is he effectively dead to anything, but it's not even clear he has the game won in 2 turns.
Yeah.
Yeah. He's doing how much damage this turn? He's putting him down to 16. So he does have 12. He has lethal for
he
sure.
He would
next
win
turn.
Next turn.
He does
yeah.
have lethal next turn. So if UCCU finds anything that deals any damage right now, if he draws a Tunnel Trog or a Feral Spirits, he's not going to be able to win this turn, but almost every other card in this deck is going to win the game. And,
No,
the Lotheb.
So UCCU can't win, man. Ancestral
oh,
Knowledge, even
dear.
If he does it, he's not going to draw and do a spell that's going to be castable.
Yeah, the Lotheb wouldn't shut down any individual spell, but it does shut down drawing into another one.
Dude, we'll see if he has Bluegill Warrior in the deck now. Nope.
Oh,
that
wow.
hurts. It's a 6-mana Lightning Bolt.
Yeah.
And doesn't matter what totem it is, Daini is going to take game one. And man, when Daini passes that turn over, he's like, I'm dead. I'm dead for sure.
No,
it's
he's
an aggro shaking shaman,
his head. Oh, dear. And there it
wow.
is. So clutch Lotheb shutting down the lightning bolt UCCU drew off of that Ancestral Knowledge gives Daini game one.
Yeah. Really nicely played by Daini. It looked a little bit risky, you know, saving that Lotheb for so long, but ended up paying off big time.
Yeah. I mean, it was a very, very close game, to say the least.
Yeah.
Yeah. Daini passing at 1 life just saying, please don't kill me, please don't kill me. And he was really struggling to get anything going early on in that game. But yeah, it is now 1-0 for Daini.
Yeah, win for Daini. He's got to get wins with Mage and Druid yet. UCCU can switch over to the Mage and Druid on his side if he wants to. Go for it again. Could stick with that Shaman. Well, in this particular case, a lot of players tend to go with, I'm going to use what I perceive as the weakest deck going forward and then just see if I can get a win with that.
So I think that at this stage of this kind of tournament, where they're playing in group stages, where the information the player's decks isn't available yet, in general, I think it's in the best interest of the player who lost to stick with the same deck.
Yeah.
Because they need to win with that deck no matter what. They need to get a win there, so they don't want to give away any information they don't have to.
Very, very true. Well, let's get some more information for ourselves here and get to know UCCU a little bit better.
My name is UCCU. 然后我现在住在台湾，然后24岁，我很喜欢台湾，因为台湾是一个非常棒的地方，它的东西非常的好吃，然后还有夜市，在台湾觉得很好笑，叫做 哈哈哈，你看看你 ，and then， 所以说我就取了这个 ID 这样子。因为我现在算是没有工作，我就是早上起来吃个饭打炉石，然后吃午餐打炉石，然后晚餐打炉石跟 Overwatch， 然后就结束这一天了。其实那只猫是在台中念书的时候捡到的，然后它会站在萤幕前面，然后有时候甚至会占领我的键盘，不让我玩滑鼠之类的。我就会说喊哪，然后就把它弄走之类的。可是它过没多久又回来这样子，它又很凶，然后爪子又很长，不过它还是一只蛮黏人的猫这样子。这只就是哈娜的杰作 ，Like This。我会希望说，像台湾现在电竞产业刚发展的，我希望它如果以炉石来讲，我希望它可以达到跟韩国一样的境界，是说之后能有更多的比赛在台湾出现这样子。其实一开始在比赛的时候，家人并不知道我在干什么，然后结果后来我打进冠亚区的时候，然后我跟他们讲说我要出国了，然后他说真的假的要出国了，然后他们才慢慢知道说原来这个玩这个东西可以出国，然后可以有一个好的发展这样子，然后他们后来就蛮支持我的。因为现在好不容易有一个亚太区可以打啊，这个是算是我目前来讲最大的比赛了，然后希望自己可以打出一点名声出来，然后当然为国争光。我觉得台湾在亚洲区算强的 ，America is the best region。卡帕。大家好，我是 UCCU 啊，这次我代表台湾到亚太区做比赛，那这次的比赛我会全心尽力，希望我可以把冠军带回台湾。
Some attitude coming out of UCCU, but did you notice how his cat looked like progressively more terrified in every picture until at the very end that cat had the same face that like handsome guy did when the Ragnaros came out of the Unstable Portal in game two of the last set?
Well,
same face.
UCCU, he's come back from those scratches, so I think maybe he's
in a
position to come back here.
You know, he's okay.
He's taken some brutal beatings from that cat, so.
That cat looked dangerous, man. He has fought that cat, and he's lived to make it to the Asia-Pacific Championships, but can he fight back against Daehyun Lee? It was close. Game one was about as close as it gets.
It doesn't get much closer than that.
Very, very true. We'll see what these guys decide to go with for game number two as they move in with that epic camera shot.
Kappa, really? Come on, man.
Oh, that's the game we're talking about. Hearthstone Heroes of Warcraft. Oh, now I know. Okay. Thank you. So, Daehyun Lee taking on UCCU in game number two. And Daehyun Lee, man, like, it's rare when you see someone have this much fun with the game at the competitive level, man. I mean, doesn't get too worried about it. Looks like it's going to be a Freeze Mage versus some mid-range Druid going on in game number two.
That's not fun.
Is it? Well, yeah.
Daehyun Lee was saying, you know, oh, he surprised everyone with his decks, and so far, what's surprising about them is that they're not very surprising at all.
I don't know, it was kind of a surprise Lothep at the end. Like, surprise, I'm at one health and you can't kill me. That's a little bit, not quite the same surprise you're thinking of, but speaking of surprises, I'm a little bit surprised to see an Ancient of War over on UCCU's side.
Ancient of War is a card we've seen occasionally in these mid-range Druid decks. It's very strong if you are able to survive to the later turns or able to pick up Innervate and Wildgrowth early on. It can help you actually win against decks like the aggro Warlock deck that can typically be very difficult.
Well, it's an interesting card to think about against like Freeze Mage too, because it's either going to soak a lot of spell damage that would be ideally sent towards the face, you know, or it's going to probably get in and do a lot of damage.
It is difficult to kill it with damage-based removal. That's which is certainly true. But UCCU, with a little bit of an awkward draw here, he has that Ancient of War as his only real threat. He definitely wants to save those keepers to use on Doomsayer or perhaps Mad Scientist.
Oh, yeah.
Daehyun Lee, he is setting up, just kind of getting set up here. Ice Block after the Ice Barrier is triggered.
Yeah, I mean, he's got the late game in his hand already, man. Alex Strauss is showing up a little bit early, but at least it's there. I mean, he'll probably get a chance to get there without taking too much damage. So coin, innervate, and that is going to be a pretty, pretty quick Ancient of War. Yeah, totally, dude.
Uproot.
No, it's just a 5-10.
Riot.
Oh, well. You know, I suppose technically, no, he couldn't have killed it. I guess, what? Frostbolt Ice Lance would have ended it if it was uprooted, but now we're going to kind of see what we were talking about. That 5-10 is going to be hard to get rid of.
Yeah, generally speaking, this matchup is in the advantage fairly significantly for the Druid player.
Yeah.
They're able to deal a lot of damage from hand thanks to the Force of Nature Savage War combo and have that Keeper of the Grove, which is so key at dealing with Doomsayer, which is
right.
A very important element of the removal suite from the Freeze Mage deck.
Do you ever think about like getting kind of cavalier with this first Keeper of the Grove, and you maybe use it to just take out the Acolyte of Pain, build your board a little bit more?
There's some appeal to that, given that Dione, you know, doesn't necessarily have all the tools he needs at his disposal.
Yeah.
But it doesn't necessarily do that much, given that you're representing a lot of damage on board that's very difficult for everyone to deal with, and you don't want to leave yourself open to a possible Doomsayer, especially when you have a threat as big as that Ancient of Lore.
Yeah. It's a little bit safer to drop that Druid of the Claw, I suppose.
I'd love to see a cat for fight here.
I know, right? Might as well. No, he's going to go the safe option.
No uproot and no fight.
I know. It's one of the least aggro set of turns we've seen. Well, aside from like the armor up pass that we've seen from a lot of warriors over the years.
Kind of how things go. How things go. But Fireball will take out that Druid. It didn't even deal any damage, if only it was a cat.
I know. That's, well, UCCU, you'd think he'd be used to cats doing damage, right? With what we just talked about. He should know how to play that Druid of the Claw in that situation.
Well, he's used to swipe. He's got two of them in his hand and takes a lot of them on his arms.
It's true. This is like the deck that UCCU has the most personal connection to.
It's got cats and things that cats do.
Yep, wild animals, just like UCCU. He's a wild animal, man. You can't contain him.
Well, he can't contain his wild
animal. He can't contain his own wild animal. That's true. See, if the cat was here, I'd go right for the jugular right now with him tilting his head like that.
I might go for the jugular here with that swipe. Send a message.
Yeah.
Swipe his face.
I mean, you're not going to find a lot of other uses for it in this matchup. No, I mean,
in all seriousness, against Freeze Mage, in many cases, yes, do it. Yes.
I am totally on board with this. Just hero power up and rock in there for one damage. And that Ancient of War, man, it's really hard to get rid of. Okay, so Doomsayer in the hand of Dione now. But Keeper of the Grove. Already ready to handle
it. He currently doesn't have Frost Nova.
That too.
Nor does he have. He could potentially play that and use an Ice Lance on that Ancient to stop the ability for UCCU to easily remove the Doomsayer. But right now he's got that second Ice Barrier that he's hovering over the board there, able to set him up to effectively 24 health. So not too terrible a spot.
I mean, he's delaying, but the issue is kind of what we were talking about, where, you know, what's going to stop this board from building up even more? He needs to draw those cards.
So he plays a Doomsayer. UCCU could just kill this on board fairly easily. He could also just use a Keeper and not waste any damage on it.
I kind of like the Keeper a little bit better, you know?
Yeah, from Daihini's perspective, I think that he's totally happy to play that Doomsayer to absorb 7 damage. Because right now, it's clear that UCCU can kill it. So I think that your best move this turn is probably just going to be neutralize that and still just get damage into Daihini's face.
Yeah. Yeah, which UCCU should be able to do pretty easily. Draws into the Ancient of Lore with that 1 damage Wrath onto the Novice Engineer.
And it looks like he's kind of debating his options, but it's not much of a decision, I think. Getting the Keeper there does just keep pushing damage for face. So Daihini facing down a pretty huge board now and has had that Doomsayer removed effectively.
Yeah, totally. And the Ice Barrier ended up being, you know, roughly just a 1-turn delay, too, which isn't a whole lot against a big Druid board.
And importantly, UCCU has had an opportunity to use his hero power several times. So he's even built up a little bit of padding for his life total if Daihini is able to get that Astraza off.
All right, now he's probably going to Ice Lance that Ancient of War and really try to make this Doomsayer work. But unfortunately...
UCCU really has all the answers here with that second copy of Keeper of the Grove. He can neutralize that as well. He could, if he really wanted to, save the Keeper or even Keeper his own Ancient to attack into it. That's not really something you. That's something you do like Dr. Boom, who's frozen, because you get the freeze off that. But in this case, you lose the buff.
You basically do five.
Turn into a five.
Own...
Yeah, you turn into a 5/5 rather than a 5/10.
Yeah.
So no real reason to not silence the Doomsayer here.
True. What about just something like Swipe Wrath? I mean, it's two spells from your hand, but you save that silence in case you need it for something else. Although there is really not a lot of other silence targets now that the Doomsayer's down.
Well, one key thing, as we were just mentioning, the Keeper can remove the silence effect from your own minions.
True.
So if you do end up with one of your minions Frost Nova'd or Blizzarded late in the game, you can use that Keeper to get them attacking right away.
Well, looks like he's just going to use the silence to neutralize that other Doomsayer.
I think what UCCU is likely considering is whether he wants to deploy more to the board with that mind control tech or cycle Wrath and use his hero power.
Now here comes Alex Strasza. So UCCU does go down to 15 health. There's Dr. Boom though, and I mean, even with the damage in Tiny's hand, do you think he can actually pull this off? Well, with the heal, I think it's going to be pretty tough now.
Yeah, so UCCU uses that Ancient to go back up to 20, effectively 24 now with that armor. So despite the Alexstrasza, that armor does allow him to just keep getting his life total a little bit out of range.
I was thinking maybe if the lore didn't go down, we could have seen like a Pyroblast into Frostbolt Ice Lance with maybe another card drawn for the win, but it just doesn't look like Dainese going to have it. He's going to have to keep delaying. I mean, he's got both Blizzards in his hand, so he can do it for a little while.
What to do?
Yeah, he's able to Blizzard here, and it's actually fairly key that Blizzard locks a bunch of minions on the board. It does mean that Force of Nature isn't nearly as threatening, though if he is looking to, like, he's going to take out that Ancient. That will get a bunch of damage on Alexstrasza as well, so UCCU will be looking to get rid of that next turn so Dainese doesn't get any free damage from it.
Yeah, well, he's got a couple ways to do that already. Frostbolt, maybe you go to face with the Frostbolt Ice Lance? I think the Forgotten Torch is a little bit better here. You want to save that utility until you absolutely need to use it, right?
Yeah, Dainese, looks like he is going to go ahead and it looks like he's Frostbolting because he may want to play Mad Scientist. I believe we've actually seen all of his secrets so far. I was actually just going to Frostbolt Ice Lance right away.
Okay. Well, I mean, he locks up UCCU, but yeah, I mean, going back to that, those cards give you the freeze effect. They have utility, whereas Forgotten Torch does damage. Mm-hmm. Are you really that worried about the Druid attacking in? Do you think that was a right move at the time?
I think that it's totally reasonable there to just kind of try to set up the ability to win the game in a couple of turns. Dainese, I think, recognizes that he's under a lot of pressure here. He's going to have to use his resources pretty quickly and hope that UCCU doesn't have things like Swipe and Force of Nature to break his block from this frozen board. But unfortunately for him, UCCU has both of those.
Well, there goes Ice Block number one. And what does he draw into? Frost Nova. Okay, so he can do a couple things here. He can Ice Block Frost Nova, Forgotten Torch, I suppose.
It looks like what he's trying to set up for here that will allow him to potentially draw, say, Fireball into Blizzard and then Pyroblast the following turn.
Yeah.
We know that UCCU has a lot of tools to make that not necessarily a winning line, however.
Right. I mean, here he's just got the Force of Nature. He can pop the second Ice Block, and he can put Dainese at just one health, too, for the following turn, where he can just move in with the Druid Hero Power Kill.
Even Dr. Boom here, of the Boom Bots, can threaten to break the Ice Block if Blizzard is cast.
True.
Not even threaten to break the Ice Block, threaten to actually kill Dainese. The problem is that there are those two Doomsayers on the board, so they actually are shielding Dainese from the possibility of Boombots guaranteeing lethal.
They're just like over there miming wildly about the end of the world, and nobody really notices.
Yeah, and one life for Dainese, and he picks up Roaring Torch, so if he had a little bit more time, maybe he could Pyroblast Torch, but he is not going to have what he needs to get out of this game. UCCU looks to be about to even this one up at 1-1.
I think so. I mean, this is Freeze Mage, right? You either tend to win with, like, one turn remaining, or you tend to lose, like, one turn away from being able to finish them off.
It is not the win for Dainese. It will be 1-1. UCCU picks up a key win here to keep in the series.
Yeah, so we have ourselves a series on our hands now, all tied up. No 3-0s going to happen so far today.
Yeah, I mean, this is one that UCCU really expects to win. The Freeze Mage versus Druid matchup pretty heavily favors the Druid. And Druid in general is a very strong class that can win against pretty much anything. Mm-hmm. So not really out of expectation this would happen.
That's right. So if you're Daihini, you probably want to stick with the mage again. Again, like we talked about earlier, if you start losing, you probably want to hang on to the same deck, because if you can win, well, I mean, you're going to give away all your answers.
Well,
he's already
revealed information here. You know, this is a freeze mage, and there's not that much to conceal about a druid deck either, generally speaking, unless it's a really weird druid deck.
You never know, man.
It could be something unusual.
He said he brought a weird deck.
It's possible that this druid deck is something unusual, but he's going to have to win with both of them regardless, and Druid isn't usually one you're kind of aiming to protect.
Yeah, well, let's take a second to get to know Daihini a little bit better and see if we can kind of get some insight into what a thought process might be in Korea's most popular streamer's mind.
하스스톤 말고는 거의 취미가 없다고시피 할 정도로 저는 하스스톤을 굉장히 좋아합니다. 약간 놀리는 식으로 애들이 따윤이 따윤이 이런 식으로 하는 놀림감이 됐었는데 흔히들 말하는 이제 한국에서 말하는 돌게임 페인이라는 뜻이 있는데 예, 그게 굉장히 또 저에 와닿는 것 같아요.
뭐야 이거? 아! 깡패! 에이! 아!
하스스톤을 좋아하게끔 사람들이 재밌어 하는 것들을 많이 보여드리고 싶어요. 하스스톤의 재미를. 사람들이 보면서 웃을 수 있는 그런 방송을 많이 만들고 싶고 최종 목표는 사람들한테 이제 알려져 있는 영어 좀 하스스톤 했으면 따윤이다 이런 고유 명사가 좀 되고 싶습니다. 이번에 또 OGN에서 했던 한국 챔피언십에서도 4강 때 되게 재밌는 모습 많이 보여드렸거든요. 리노 잭슨이 나와가지고 램실드랑 그래서 살아났던 그 기억이 있는데
That is really good. That is 9 extra health against a fatiguing opponent. That's the win. That is huge. That's game over.
이번 대회 역시도 또 저만의 덱을 하나 또 준비해서 가지고 왔습니다. 많은 분들이 아마 또 보면 되게 좋아하지 않을까 생각을 합니다. 그냥 오늘부터 Do you know 따위 아니면 No I don't가 아니라 Yes I do. 월드 노우 따윤이, 스페이스 노우 따윤이 만들겠습니다. 지켜봐 주세요.
아, man, I have been casting the Korean region for a couple of years now, and Daihini is absolutely my favorite player to cast. He is so entertaining, loves to have fun with the game, but where are the weird decks? Follow through with the promise, Daihini.
UCCU was the one who said Kappa in his interview. I think Daihini was missing that after I brought these custom homemade decks here.
Daihini's like dead serious about everything he says, but we'll see if a Kappa needs to get inserted later. We can like go back and record him doing that, you know? Yeah. If he doesn't bring one, we're going to make him. We're going to make him record the Kappa. Might as well.
Yeah, absolutely. But no, after that video, it's hard not to root for him. You know, he really has such a energetic personality, you know, fun-loving. He really, like I said, he kind of feels like a kindred spirit to me.
And I can't think of anybody else in the world who's won a tournament match with both Ramshield before, too. I think that's got to be a first as well. But looks like we're about ready to go into our third game. Guys, Daihini taking on UCCU. We're all tied up at 1-1. Daihini not quite able to get a win with the Freeze Mage in game number two. It was close. It was like one turn away. Where do we go from here?
This is definitely still anyone's game to win here. UCCU, with his mage, this is not Freeze Mage, however. UCCU is bringing Tempo Mage.
Okay, here's a druid from Daihini, looking to be about the most normal druid in the world. Oh, Daihini. I'm coming with the voice recorder. He's going to have to say Kappen.
We got to get that you know, edited out.
Yep. Maybe I'll just do it in my own voice at the end. You just
Kappa.
Like, Kappa, yeah. All right, well, Tempo Mage taking on the druid, and he's going to start right away with the Living Roots. So, wow, getting aggressive.
Yeah, well, this is interesting because typically, Druid versus Mage, if the Mage is Freeze, is a very bad matchup. As we just saw UCCU play Druid and take down Daihini playing Freeze Mage. And look, a roll of the eyes, shake of the head for Daihini. Not Freeze Mage, not what he was hoping for.
Nope.
He was really hoping that this was going to be him doing to UCCU what he had gotten done to him last game.
So the Gurabashi Berserker picked up with the Unstable Portal, and funny enough, that's actually a pretty good card to throw against Dainese right now.
It's actually huge.
Yeah.
You know, this is a 7-health minion where Druid is a class that typically has a bit of difficulty dealing with large health minions, and it's got those saplings to feed on the board.
Dude, like Unstable Portal so far has been really delivering today.
Yeah, no, we've seen some big minions come off of that. We see the Ragnaros in UCCU's hand. He's like, oh, no, I just came off of a portal. Come over here, Gurabashi Berserker. Come join me.
Yeah, well, I mean, we've seen Ragnaros and Unstable Portal in the hand at the same time, but this time it didn't come out of the portal. Just normally in UCCU's deck. And he's just going to throw out the Emperor Thorazin. I mean, it's hard to argue with that. It's what's going to handle the Gurabashi Berserker probably the cleanest, even though it doesn't give you that great mana reduction that you're hoping to get out of Emperor.
I mean, reducing two mid-range cards in your hand is fine. It's not really amazing, especially considering next turn, Dainese would have been able to play either of those regardless. But definitely better than not having a big play this turn, since he's, as early as turn two, already pretty behind.
Yeah. We'll see if he can kind of catch up. You notice him, like, looking over at UCCU during the game, he's like making motions down his monitor. He's trying to get in his head too.
I mean, he's also just very expressive. You know, yeah. A lot of players as they're playing, they're just kind of, you know, not really making much expressions on the camera. Most of the time, we see people very stone-faced, stoic, but he's definitely not one of those players.
All right, well, Berserker goes down to 1 health, so Emperor Thor isn't doing his job. That Berserker damage never went to the face.
Yeah.
This plays the Azure Drake, and that's a pretty good card to draw on curve for UCCU.
Yep, Piloted Shredder does threaten that Azure Drake potentially, though the reduced cost Drew to the Claw can come down alongside this Wrath, so
yeah.
It can actually even cycle it. No, he goes with the full damage. No, he does cycle because that sapling can take out the rest of the Shredder here. So
yeah, saw Cutpurse for just a second. He was like, oh yeah, I'm in the game, and he just immediately dies.
Just kidding.
Poor guy. He's gone to join the town scrub.
And then this is actually a pretty good turn here for UCCU, able to remove all of Dainese's minions thanks to the cost reduction off of the Sorcerer's Apprentice there. But Dr. Boom
makes right
things a little bit less exciting here. But ooh,
okay.
Flame Waker, that's a scary proposition. UCCU can cast Flame Waker and Fireball. If one of those, one or more of those Flame Wakers, well, one of them hits Dr. Boom, he's able to remove that without necessarily losing his Sorcerer's Apprentice. But if he casts it and then fireballs and one of the Boom bots kills Sorcerer's Apprentice and none of the hits hit Dr. Boom, Dr. Boom lives.
What would you say about maybe Flame Waker and then Frostbolt into the Dr. Boom? You'd lock it up either way. And then if one of the damage hits it, again, you can trade with your Sorcerer's Apprentice.
Yeah.
Still get the Unstable Portal off for next turn.
It's not as YOLO a play.
No, it's not. You're right.
But the problem is that runs the same risk, since if your apprentice dies to one of the Boom bots, which gets hit by Flame Waker, you don't have the ability to remove Dr. Boom on board. You have to spend additional resources.
Yeah.
It's at least frozen if you use the Frostbolt, though.
So you're tempted to just run the Sorcerer's Apprentice in early on, even though it may mean you don't get to cast Bolt spells?
Looks like he's going
for
the Frostbolt, and...
All right.
And...
Oh, man.
Okay.
3 damage onto that Flame Waker. He does clear Dr. Boom, though. So he got something out of it, but still not the greatest result for UCCU.
So Dainese, this is the stage of the game where the Druid generally can pull ahead.
Yeah.
Often the Tempo Mage player is advantaged in the early turns, though we did see Dainese with the... Wild Growth into Innervate Emperor, which forced UCCU to take a reactive position, which is not where the Tempo Mage wants to be in this spot.
Oh, there's a card that we used to see a lot in Mage decks, but not quite as effective when it comes out of an unstable portal in Tempo Mage.
Yeah, though UCCU being able to deploy a threat and remove Dainese's threat this turn allows UCCU to get into turn 8 with a reasonable position when he plays Ragnaros.
That is nice. Raven Idol in this Dione deck, so there's a little bit of a change from the usual.
That's a little bit unusual. I don't know if that's you know.
It doesn't qualify as crazy.
I was gonna say,
not really.
That's no Golden Monkey. When I see Elise, I'll be happy.
We'll assume it was a Warrior deck, maybe. Maybe he's running Face Warrior or something.
All right. Good or at least Golden Warrior. Monkey in that Warrior deck.
Yes. Oh, definitely. All right.
I hope so.
Ragnaros could come down this turn.
Yeah, UCCU can play that Ragnaros and potentially kill one of Dione's minions, or just go face. The problem is Dione has so many more cards in hand.
Yeah, he's got a lot of card advantage right now. And as from UCCU's perspective, you're 21 health with that board. You get really, really worried because suddenly you're in a position where the combo can just kill you when it's combined with the minions that are already out there. So you kind of feel compelled to prioritize removal more than anything, don't you?
Yeah, I think that UCCU looks like he's going to play the Ragnaros. Seems like a pretty obvious play here. He definitely wants to get that down and start getting burns on those insects across the table.
Gives you the highest chance of clearing the most minions. There we go, Bluegill Warrior. So he did reduce a lot of damage, though, which is nice.
What do we have here?
Astral Communication. No, I'm just kidding. Communion. Astral Communion.
Yeah, he could draw a card, discard his hand, draw a card by gaining a mana crystal at 10 mana. So.
It would be great. It would be just awesome.
The Starfire actually has to be kind of attractive.
You're right.
With Starfire, he can't quite take care of Ragnaros easily, but it is the highest value
Where
card here.
True.
Yeah, we're going to see Cat plus Swipe, I think, take down Ragnaros. No, Ragnaros lives.
Cat plus Swipe was the name of the boy band I was in high school.
It's actually, he's just pushing face on UCCU, who does have Azure Drake and the Arcane Blast, which can take out the cat. UCCU, you know, he has a lot of problems with cats, we've learned. So
yeah,
definitely got to get rid of that one. And then Ping takes out the Bluegill Warrior. So Dione is in a position where if he draws Force of Nature, he can end the game in the spot.
Right, UCCU is still dead to the combo. Still dead to the combo, even though the Pilot Shredder gets taken out, and it's
There's
Swipe.
A Swipe.
He's getting to the point where he's going to do a lot of damage.
He can clear the board if he chooses. He could double Swipe Ragnaros and send the Crazed Alchemist into that Azure Drake.
Yep.
And still potentially either attack with his hero power or cycle the Wild Growth.
I think the double Swipe is probably what we're going to see. I mean, it's just the cleanest way to eliminate the board.
It also gets some damage in your opponent's face. Oh, yeah. Is he going to Savage Roar?
That would be kind of surprising.
Wow.
Is he just going to go face? He's just kind of assuming
that Savage
Roar can't finish.
Is he just Savage Roar Swipe? Okay.
Huh.
Well, what he's trying to do here, he's setting up the Starfire plus Swipe to kill his opponent.
Right.
But we see that UCCU has that Lotheb in hand, so it's not going to work right now.
I was going to say, I think Dione is trying to style a little bit on his opponent.
Counterspell.
Oh, boy.
Oh, my.
Uh-oh. Things are about to get a little bit awkward for Dione, I think.
Well, the thing is that Dione is still at 30, effectively. He has 29 health and 1 armor. So he's just setting up to be able to use these damage spells to win the game over the course of a couple of turns. He doesn't necessarily need that much time. You know, this Ragnaros can do a lot of damage every turn, but now 7 health for Dione. Or 7 health for UCCU, Dione can just Swipe face here even though it's his only play.
Yeah.
And then follow up with Starfire the following turn.
Yeah, and he seems to have it locked in.
Yeah, he even has extra cheap spells that if he thinks about it, can play around that counterspell as well.
Yeah. I mean, and in this situation, you're always going to use the Living Roots first if you're worried at all that it might be a counterspell. So there it is, 4 damage from Swipe. Flame Cannon doesn't really help UCCU that much. All he can do is really push damage and play the counterspell. But Dione, if he plays this in the right order, should have the win.
The thing is, even if he doesn't, he can Starfire first, and then he still has Living Roots for 2 damage to actually close things out. So Dione, he's taken some hits from Ragnaros, but not fast enough. Living Roots triggers a counterspell, and that Starfire will end the game.
Wow. Talk about things you haven't seen in a while. Starfire ending the game, and UCCU is like, yep, thanks, Raven Idol. Dione, look at that smug look on his face. He's like, yeah, I killed him with Starfire.
Gotcha.
The fans are sated once again.
And that was a matchup where UCCU was hoping to come out ahead.
Yeah.
You bring Tempo Mage because you are hoping to use it to beat your opponent's Druid. So now he's definitely in a little bit of an awkward spot because he needs to find a win with that Tempo Mage deck against a deck that's not necessarily built to beat.
Right. Dainey just sitting there with that face that says, yeah, it was all part of the plan.
Yeah, so
I knew I was going to draw it.
Dainey has that Freeze Mage deck remaining.
Yeah.
And then UCCU has Tempo Mage and Aggro Shaman, both of which can kind of struggle against Freeze Mage because Freeze Mage with Ice Barrier can do a lot to buy effective health against the Aggro Shaman. And against the Tempo Mage, if you happen to get a mirror entity off of a Mad Scientist and your opponent plays Doomsayer into it, that goes badly for you.
Yep, exactly. I mean, so if you're a Dainey, I suppose you're probably feeling pretty good right now. You're like, all right, I'm just gonna, I've got two chances to win against two decks that Freeze Mage is pretty good against. Should be okay. Looks like we're going right into it, though. We'll see what UCCU decides to bring in to try to take down Dainey. There's another hand gesture, man. Dainey's just like all over the place.
Yeah,
but
I mean,
this is the moment. This is the time to get serious.
And he's got to be feeling good here. You know, yeah. He has just one deck remaining to win with, and as we said, two matchups that certainly not the underdog.
Right. I wouldn't say so. And time to move into what could be the last game of our second match. Dainey with the Freeze Mage, UCCU trying to stay alive with that Aggro Shaman. Throws everything back. Let's see what he gets. Okay, Leprino, not bad. He's got the Urshock to handle, you know, one of the Doomsayers, one of the Mad Scientists if he wants to.
UCCU with the tools he needs to win. He has a reasonable opening here with that Leprino into Totem Golem. And Urshock, as you said, a great answer to possible Doomsayer. Dainey with Coin into Novice Engineer. And this is, some players might just coin and ping their opponent's Leprinome to prevent the damage.
Right.
But by playing the Novice Engineer, he gets the crucial cycle through his deck and only effectively takes two damage to kind of get another turn because he doesn't have to spend that two mana later to play the Novice Engineer.
Yeah, more yet, more or less. And there we go. I mean, it's a great time to play that Doomsayer. It forces some spells out of your opponent's hands. See if UCCU wants to commit to the Earthshock right now. I think it's a pretty good option. Yep, he's going to go with it.
Yeah, you need to get all of the minion damage in that you can in matchup. And getting that Earthshock, there's really no better target. Dainey, he has a couple of options here. He can just play Ice Barrier, or looks like he may just play this second Doomsayer.
Why not?
And I like this because not only does it deal with this Totem Golem on the board pretty well, it does also give you the ability to shut down your opponent from developing additional minions as well. So UCCU, what he really needs to find, the key card for the Shaman deck in this match is Doomhammer.
Right.
Doomhammer gives the Shaman the ability to generate a lot of damage that really can't easily be stopped by the freeze effects or removal from the Freeze Mage. But without Doomhammer, he can often struggle.
Wow, and he's just gonna crackle the face. Goes in. That's three damage to the face. And see, we talked about how important Doomhammer was. I've played a ton of Aggro Shaman games, and you never want to overload yourself on turn four. Do you think that was maybe a little bit overeager?
Yeah, I mean, he wants to get that damage at some point. He does not draw Doomhammer this turn. So I think that Doomhammer is the only card he would really want to cast next turn that he wouldn't be able to cast without the fifth mana. And he needs to pace himself such that he can actually play all of these cards.
True.
And you can't just sit back and play all of your burn at the same time, because in many cases, you just won't have enough damage.
And what's Finley going to give him? All right, Fire Blast, Shapeshift, an option. Shapeshift is probably the second best.
Oh, goes
wow,
with
he's
going to
go with the draw, yeah.
So this is a very aggressive line from UCCU. He wants to try and find Doomhammer enough damage to close the game as quickly as possible. He isn't really going to use that Life Tap that many times.
Probably
he's
not.
He's just digging to find that Doomhammer that he needs.
Okay. Well, Dainey handling the minions that are on the board takes a little bit more damage, but now he's got one of his secrets out, so he can delay this game a little bit longer. Keep himself alive. It's a nice minion draw for UCCU. Gets to find out what kind of secret it is. But, you know, the interesting situation you find yourself in is, do you want, you have a decent amount of spells and spell damage in your hand, do you maybe just try to finish them with spells, and if you're worried about it being Ice Barrier, what do you think?
Yeah, you are in a position where, you know, you can use that Life Tap, try and dig a little bit. The problem with not attacking your opponent in the face is that you remove exactly that Doomhammer from relevance. UCCU, he has a pretty clear tell. We actually see Dainey notice that. We see he's clearly distraught by this draw and reveals that information to Dainey.
Yeah, I mean, UCCU is, he's wearing his heart on his sleeve right now, but not in a way you probably should be if you're sitting right across from your opponent in a tournament.
Yeah. Many of these players probably don't play very many live events.
Yeah.
And here. We see that we see UCU giving away a little bit of information. Does send that horse rider to the face. It is ice barrier.
Yeah.
Okay. So that does give Dainese a bit of extra life here to work with.
And the lightning bolt goes to the face too, just trying to get rid of as much armor as you can. And you know, you and I have played a lot of face-to-face card games over the years. You've done a little bit better than I have in those. But yeah, you just never want to give your opponent tells like that. It's dangerous stuff.
And the key here for Dainese now, after that Doomhammer, he's in a lot of trouble.
Oh,
because
yeah.
This represents so much damage over turns that he doesn't really have great tools to deal with. This Ice Barrier will help mitigate some of it. And that's actually pretty huge. If that had been Ice Block, it would be a lot worse situation for Dainese because he doesn't want to find the block and not be able to live through the possibility of just getting the block broken with the Lava Bursts. All right, wow. So we do see this kind of unexciting Blizzard, but I think it is Dainese's best play at this point. He can Blizzard to shut down the Tunnel Trog, and he potentially attack either the face.
I was thinking about trading, yeah. Because well, then you get that first ice block out, you've already got the other one in your hands, and you can play him in succession.
I think that what Dainese is looking to do, he may be trying to actually just get damage in and hope to Alexstrasza himself.
Ah, yeah.
Because because of that Doomhammer, he really needs to try to assemble enough damage to kill UCCU naturally without using Alexstrasza offensively.
Seems that way. Lava Shock comes in, so wait for UCCU to get a few of those mana crystals back. Just going to do some damage to the face, reduce a little bit of that armor.
Yeah, and we're going to see Lava Burst you. This is a lot of damage very fast.
Yeah, I mean, he's got that Lava Shock next turn, so all this overload doesn't really make a big difference.
Yeah, though this does allow UCCU to potentially play. It looks like he's going to go with, he's going to attack here.
Yeah.
He wants to get the Ice Block out of his deck before casting Arcane Intellect to ensure that he doesn't draw the other Ice Block, which would be disastrous with that Mad Scientist in play.
Well, he's got that Ice Block in his hand, too, so he didn't want to play that one and then have Mad Scientist, not fetch the other one, too. So the ordering is definitely important.
And the key here, Dainese really wants to try to get UCCU to actually have to use that life total. Ooh, Elemental Destruction, not what he wants to draw. It's effectively a dead card in this matchup.
Yeah, that's kind of the last card in his deck he wants to see right now.
And this is a card that nearly allowed UCCU to win the match against the Warlock deck.
Yeah.
But this is definitely not where you want to be seeing it.
This could have been such a different series. I mean, remember, UCCU had Dainese down to like one health in the first game. If he had won that first one with this Aggro Shaman, we might have seen a very different series. Mm-hmm. It's close.
Yeah, and this is actually pretty crucial because now UCCU not being able to break Ice Block this turn allows Dainese to play Alexstrasza defensively to gain all this health and give himself an 8-8 threat on board as well.
Wow. Dainese sees the Abusive Sergeant get played.
Well, I'm a little curious why that Abusive Sergeant came down, because it is just a one health minion that allows the Acolyte to draw Dainese cards without having to use mana.
That seems like an overly desperate move, But Dainese may actually Alexstrasza UCCU. I mean, he's sitting at 4 health. He's got both ice blocks, one on the board, one in his hand, and he feels aggressive enough to just go for this.
Well, he has the ability to have ice block now, re-ice block next turn, and cast the fireball this turn, and then, or rather, fireball and ice block this turn, and then pyroblast the following turn.
Right.
So unless UCCU has something like Lotheb or Kizan Mystic, he really has no way to get back into this game.
Man, Kizan Mystic, that would be like the tech to end all techs in this particular game, wouldn't it?
It would be pretty good.
That would be huge. Elemental Destruction's going to get used. Try to do a little bit of damage.
Yeah, it looks like we're going to have the Lava Shocks take down Alexstrasza.
So, I guess so.
So she doesn't end the game. But I have to imagine we're just going to see Fireball to the face with Ice Block from Dainese this next turn. And then UCCU needs to draw a real miracle to win the game.
Yep, and even draws into the second fireball. So, yeah, playing that.
Oh, she doesn't even need it. Yeah, he has a Frostbolt, so he just has lethal right now.
Exactly. Yep, so there it is. Dainese is going to take this series 3-1. Wow. Yep. Putting his money where his mouth is, man. He beat UCCU pretty soundly.
Yeah, no, I mean, that was a convincing performance. We saw him prevail in even what is generally considered an unfavorable matchup with the Druid against Tempo Mage. And, came back from pretty, you know, from that one life position in that game one. So definitely quite a series.
That's right. It started out so close, but in the end, Dainey with a very, very strong start at the tournament, but still waiting to see that crazy deck, those crazy cards. I don't know. He did kill him with Starfire once, which is good. So we have our first two winners of the day already, Handsome Guy and Dainey, taking their first two best of fives.
Yeah, they will face off tomorrow. The winner of that will move on directly to the semifinals.
Yep, that's right. And Staz and UCCU going to be facing each other later on in the tournament just for that elimination match.
Yeah,
they're kind of on the bubble now. They have to win or go home.
Yeah, neither player is out just yet. This is a double elimination bracket, so anyone can still win the tournament.
Yep, that's right. They've still got a chance. Still not too bad. But now, I think it's time to go over to see what Dainey has to say after that first win. We've got Frodan over at the fireside for the interview.
Thank you very much, Doa and Brian. That's right, I'm joined by Dainey, who's the winner of his match. Moving on to tomorrow and the winners. Now, I heard that Dainey was practicing 15 hours a day for this tournament. Is that true?
하루에 이 토너먼트 위해서 12시간 연습했다는데 사실인가요?
네, 일주일 정도 이제 방송도 하지 않고 열심히 대회 준비만 열심히 했습니다.
For about a week, he didn't stream any streams, and he practiced 15 hours a day for this tournament.
What does winning this necessarily mean for you and Korea? I think Korea is also really proud of being good at a lot of other games. I think people really want to see you do well. So are you playing for more than just yourself?
이번 에픽 토너먼트 참가하시게 될 때 우승이 본인을 위한 것이 아니면 한국을 위한 것인지 어느 게 더 의미하는 것인지 말씀 부탁드립니다.
저를 위한 것도 있지만 대한민국을 위한 것 두 개 다 포함이라고 생각하시면 될 것 같습니다.
He's doing it for himself and also for Korea. So basically, he's doing it for Korea and himself.
Now, I know that before the match started, you were saying that you would bring something pretty cool to the tournament, but we saw some pretty standard stuff. It didn't seem like you were playing anything too out of the world. I'm guessing you still have some surprises. Is that true?
그 대회 초반에 인터뷰하실 때 좀 색다른 덱을 준비했다 하셨는데 지금 보시니까 다 평범한 덱들인데 혹시 앞으로의 덱들 기대도 되나요?
사실 보여준 게 거의 대부분인데 바뀐 게 그냥 일반 평범한 덱 중에서 몇 장 정도 수정한 거라서 아마 이게 보여드린 거의 전부일 수도 있을 것 같습니다.
Sorry to say, all the decks that I prepared is pretty standard. It's just that I changed a couple of the cards inside the deck, so it looked kind of cool.
Yeah, like that Raven Idol, which happened to work out really well. Well, congratulations to Dr. Nias to all the questions I have for now. Let's head over to the sidebar where TJ and D2 are standing by to break down this match.
Thank you very much, Dan, and once again, big congratulations once again to Dainey for that victory. And UCCU going to have to go down to the lower bracket and fight his way out through his group. That was an interesting match. I'm joined here on the sidebar by D2. And D2, I want to ask you first off, so far we've seen four players, so we've seen four deck lists, and all four players have brought Mage, which was a little bit of a surprise to me, but the big surprise was that two were Freeze Mage and two were Tempo Mage. Why all of a sudden are we seeing an influx of the Tempo Mage? We're used to seeing Freeze Mage now, but why the Tempo Mage all of a sudden?
Well, if you bring Freeze Mage to a tournament, it's kind of has these polarizing matchups, you know, like it's pretty weak against Warrior, kind of forced into that ban, and all of a sudden you're weak against Druid too. Now you're dropping a game, so I like having people mix it up and bring the Tempo Mage. It can secure your win earlier on, and you can maybe pick some prize money up when you do that. At the same time, you're not really forced into certain bans. You can actually just beat Druid, which is one of the more popular bans that you see in this kind of situation. So being able to beat Druid and being able to kind of, I mean, you're a bit weak to more control-y decks, but I think that's a trade-off that you have to make there.
Yeah, and there's some crazy things that Tempo Mage can do, as we've seen so far, especially with the Ragnaros that we saw earlier from the Unstable Portal. So cool things going on. But we do have a replay here from this match. It is from game number 3. And this was an interesting choice that you were talking to me a little bit about, D2. So I want you to walk me through this play, starting from the Raven Idol choice from Dainey here.
Well, I mean, he puts Raven Idol in his deck for these purposes specifically, right? He wants to put it in his deck in order to have the ability to have these kind of options available to him in tight spots like this. And realizing that he's so close to killing his opponent, Dainey says, you know what, I don't really need to kill this Ragnaros. I can kind of flood the board, do a lot of damage to face, and I can pick up a damage spell to be able to, you know, kind of pressure my opponent. And a lot of times people might go for the clear on Ragnaros there, but it's really a dangerous proposition because once you start getting into, you know, those trades, you start using all your removal for that situation, and maybe you get into a top deck war and your opponent can outdraw you. In that situation, Dahyun looked at that situation. He said that that was the best chance for him to win. It was very unlikely for UCCU to come back and be able to burst him down because he'd already used, Dahyun's had already seen two fireballs and a frostball at that point. Really unlikely for UCCU to kind of race him at that situation. So I like the call from Dahyun, just go aggressive.
Yeah, and it ended up working out for him. He was put in a tight spot towards the end of that match where if he hadn't gotten that face damage earlier, probably would have been a different story in that game because he was cutting it close. Real quickly, before we have to move on to the next match, I want to get your thoughts on the Raven Idol card. Because as we heard Dan mention, do you have any more surprises or any cool things like that Raven Idol? What are your thoughts on this card, D2?
Well, Raven Idol is a card that's really been popular in the Chinese meta. Obviously, China and Korea are completely different countries, but it's something that you put in your deck for moments exactly like that, right? You need to have a kind of a discover situation where you need to have an exact answer. Sometimes you need minions. Sometimes when, you know, Druid runs into these situations where if they have all spells, they're really in trouble. And if they have all minions, kind of the same spot if they're behind on the board. So really good to see kind of interesting tech cards to be able to get out of, you know, binds like that.
All right, well, thank you very much, D2, for your expert analysis on that matchup. We are going to move to the third match of the day, which is between Naviyut and Matsuun. And we're actually going to take a look at Matsuun's run through the Japanese preliminaries. But before we do that, let's take a look at some highlights from the last match.